Fine. You ready?
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Bismillah, alhamdulillah, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
Alright, so we have the different categories and different types of ashaka. And like any other issue, there are going to be, or there's going to be a ton of things over which the scholars of Islam agree. And there's going to be other things over which they disagree regarding the shafa'ah. Point number two. There are going to be things that we believe and we accept and embrace according to the orthodox creed of Islam. The Puritan creed of Islam. And there are going to be other things in which other Muslims believe and embrace and understand regarding shafa'ah, which are incorrect because their creed is not orthodox. It's not the correct aqidah. Everyone understand this? First point was, is that there are things of which the Muslims agree on and the scholars of Islam agree on, and then other things of which they differ concerning shafa'ah and other issues. Number two, there's going to be the orthodox creed of Islam that is directly based off of Quran and Sunnah. And then there are going to be other beliefs about shafa'ah, even if it's not shirk and bid'ah, but it's going to be misguidance because their creed is not directly extracted from the Quran and Sunnah. You understand this? Freshly squeezed orange juice is not, it does not taste, it does not look like, it does not smell the same as pasteurized orange juice. We can agree on that. Freshly squeezed orange juice does not look and taste as orange juice that's been pasteurized and has been sitting in a refrigerator or a freezer, let alone from concentrate. Sahih? It's a whole different juice. So the creed that's directly taken from Quran and Sunnah, the orthodox creed, the Aqidah of Ahlul Sunnah wal Jama'ah, that's the freshly squeezed from the Valencia orange. Orange is cut, pressed, bismillah. That's it. And those other creeds in which there's some Quran and Sunnah, there's some what the Sahaba said, but there's a little bit of this and a taint of that, and this is a coloring, and this is concentrated, and this is a preservative, and this is pasteurized, and on top of all of that, it's been sitting on the shelf for a month or a week or however long it's been sitting, or in the freezer. The orange juice is not the same. It's not what? It's not the same orange juice. Everyone understand this? But it's still orange juice. It's still a strand of Islam. And they're Muslims. But it doesn't mean that that's the pure way. So every book that you may come across regarding intercession is not freshly squeezed. Every cultural practice that the Muslims have concerning intercession is not what? It's not freshly squeezed or freshly grounded, right? Freshly grounded, It's not the same. Instant coffee is not like what? Freshly roasted coffee beans. Forget freshly ground, freshly roasted. Taking the beans and grinding them and making coffee, that's one level. Everyone knows that's one what? That's one level. Alhamdulillah, when I was in Medina and other parts of Saudi Arabia, I met a few brothers, alhamdulillah, who had families from Ethiopia. And in my honest opinion, and I'm not a big coffee drinker, I like coffee, I enjoy it when I have it, but I'm not a big coffee drinker. I'm more of a tea guy. But the best coffee that I've ever had in my life is the coffee that comes from Ethiopia. Hands down. And one of the reasons why it's the best coffee, in my humble opinion, is not because they use freshly ground beans, but they use freshly roasted beans. It's a big difference, right? And when you buy the green beans yourself and cook them and roast them, then you do what? Grind them up. Stay with me now. Instant coffee, Nescafe, that's one level, right? Then having good coffee beans, wherever they come from, Kenya, Nicaragua, Colombia, wherever the coffee beans come from, and you grinding it up, that's also, that's another what? That's higher than the quick stuff. But it's not the same as taking the what? The green beans, and then you yourself what? Roasting them, and then grinding them. That's a higher level now. Everyone understand this? So I'm trying to make a tangible point here. I know we have some brothers and sisters from Ethiopia. They didn't feel happy. Alhamdulillah. There's nothing wrong with that. Tayyib. Ethiopia, among many things, has many, many, many virtues. In Islam and outside of Islam. Some of the people say, experts say, that the pure strain of Christianity is practiced in Ethiopia. Many people, they say this. That the purest understanding of Islam is in Ethiopia. I mean, the purest understanding of Christianity. I'm just trying to make a point. I'm trying to make a what? A point. The other virtues that belong to that part of the world. Huh? Many other virtues. We're not here to talk about that right now. Moving forward. Trying to stay on the topic, right? So what are you going to talk about coffee? Huh? Talking about Shafa Alahi. Fine, moving forward. Point number three is there are different types of Shafa. Levels of it. Who can mention a few? One example before we move forward of the Shafa, which is correct, the proper understanding thereof. And the Shafa, which is incorrect, or is an incorrect understanding thereof, is what? What's something that the Orthodox creed of Islam supports regarding intercession? Such as what? Tell me something about Shafa that's directly from Quran and Sunnah. Quickly, guys. Quick, Qadir. You want that letter? From Medina? What is something that is correct about Shafa according to the freshly squeezed Aqidah of Islam? That the Prophet will be taught a new praise. Good. That the Prophet will be taught a what? A new praise. He will praise Allah in a way which he never praised Allah before. And this proves that Allah has more than 99 names. This proves that Allah has what? More than 99 names. Allah will give him inspiration. He will reveal to him things, ways of praising Allah, which he never did before. And what's the best and greatest way of praising Allah except for mentioning his what? His beautiful names. So this is one aspect. Now give me an aspect of an incorrect understanding or incorrect practice of Shafa with the fresh, with the instant coffee. The Aqidah, that's not the pure Aqidah of Islam. Quickly. Quickly, guys, it's supposed to be all of them, man. That someone what? Someone else will give or get? Given says, no, that's right. There are people besides the Prophet who will intercede. There are people who do what? Besides the Prophet who will what? Who will intercede by Allah's permission. We want to get there. Try again. Keep thinking. I'll come back. Yellow. That you can seek intercession from someone who's dead. Perfect example. You can seek intercession from someone who's deceased. For argument's sake, for argument's sake, he was righteous, but he's dead. He's in the grave. He does not own the Shafa, let alone give the Shafa. I would understand this? Five, another point, quickly. Pardon. Children will intercede for their parents. That is directly from the Quran and the Sunnah. They will be given the ability to do what? Intercede for their parents. Sahib, what else? Anything else? Fadl, Idris. Huh? Reading the Quran is a means of it interceding for you. Your recitation of the Quran, your righteous deeds will intercede for you. Assent. Fadl. Fasting. Give me something wrong now. I want some ready-made coffee now. Some instant coffee. Some Nescafe. Huh? Give me something that's wrong about Shafa that Muslims say and believe. Anybody else? Welcome. Making dua to the Prophet. Praying. Question about that. That's wrong. What else? That you cannot intercede for disbelievers. Wrong or right? What's that? That's freshly grounded or Nescafe? That's wrong. When can you make dua for Allah to... When can you make intercession for disbelievers? No, we're only talking right now. Only one. You can't at all. So that's a right belief or wrong belief? A correct belief. Good. I want wrong. I want a mistake. I don't want the fresh coffee. I want some powder. Out of the vending machine. Fadl. I can help you if you make dua to him, similar to what she mentioned. That's wrong. That's totally incorrect. The Prophet can help you, but not by you making dua to him and asking him. Tayyip, what else is there? Tayyip, moving forward. Accepted and rejected cause of intercession. Tayyip, the reckoning and the rukhul. This chapter is relatively abridged. What's important is these are the main types. Number one is the greater intercession. Ash-shafa'atu al-uzma. Ash-shafa'atu al-uzma. Which is also called al-maqam al-mahmud. As Allah mentions in Surah Al-Isra. Praying at night. Wa min al-layli. Allah says, pray at night. And your door will send you upon what? Maqam al-mahmuda. A praiseworthy station. And this is when the Prophet ﷺ's virtue will be manifest for all. Everyone will praise him because he begged Allah and asked Allah to commence judgment. And he gave them a bridge. They were tired and exhausted of standing and terrified about the forthcoming judgment. Number two, intercession for sinners among the monotheists, Usat al-Muwahideen, in which their people, their Muslims, who unfortunately loved eating riba, and unfortunately loved disrespecting their mothers and fathers, and unfortunately loved running from the battlefield, and unfortunately loved slandering chaste believing women, and unfortunately loved murder, and unfortunately loved all types of crimes and sins. They were evildoers, they were wicked sinners. And they die, but they're still Muslims. They're still upon the Aqidah of Tawheed. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and or other prophets and righteous servants of Allah will be given the opportunity and the honor of asking Allah not to punish them and begging Allah azza wa jal to keep them from being treated how they deserve to be treated. They deserve to go to hell. But because this righteous servant asked Allah not to send them to the hellfire, and Allah honored the status and the prestige of that righteous servant, they will be protected from going to the fire of hell. And or those sinful Muslims who went to the fire of hell, for them to be taken out of the fire of hell. Everyone understand this? This is a type of intercession. So the first type of intercession is specific to the Prophet. No one else is going to do Maqam Mahmud, except for him. Isa, Musa, this righteous, no one else but Muhammad. Second type, different story. Number three, it says other kinds of intercession which will be mentioned in the hadith, intercession of the last of people who sasanat to say at are equal. Alright? Other people who have been ordered to hell and seek to save them from it, like I just explained. Is intercession for those of enter paradise to be raised in their status. To be given a higher status than what you actually deserve in Jannah. Everyone understand this? Everyone understand this or not? Also, we have what? Intercession of the messenger for the reduction of punishment of his uncle Abu Talib, and that's specific to him. No one is going to be able to pray and intercede for a disbeliever except for the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And to show you the deepness of everything, may Allah protect us, is that he's going to pray for him, and he's not going to be saved from hell. He's not going to be kept from the punishment. The punishment is going to be reduced, waliyahubillah. It's going to be lessened upon him. He's still going to be punished. And that goes to show you that Allah Azza wa Jalla, he mentions in which that day لا تملك نفس لنفس شيئا والأمر لمن ولرسوله في قراءة صحيح والأمر يومئذ لله وللرسول والأمر يومئذ لله ولمحمد في قراءة صح أبدا. Allah on that day, لا تملك نفس لنفس شيئا. No soul has power and ability to protect and save another soul. And that day, that's sufficient. لا تملك نفس لنفس شيئا. That's sufficient. والأمر يومئذ لله. That's emphasizing the aqidah of Tawheed once more. And the command, the affair on that day will be only for Allah. Only for Allah. So even Muhammad is given the honor of asking Allah, he cannot save him from the punishment of the fire. So look at the pristine, crystal clear aqidah of Tawheed. Has nothing to do with Muhammad ibn Abdul Wahhab. Has nothing to do with Ibn Abdul Wahhab. Has to do with King Saud. It has nothing to do with Ibn Taymiyyah and Imam Ahmed. This is the Quran. Safi, clear, pristine aqidah of no one has power to do something with Allah Azza wa Jalla unless Allah allows it. I would understand the aqidah of Tawheed. It's a pure aqidah. It has nothing to do with Muhammad ibn Abdul Wahhab in Arabia. He did not make that up and bring that. That's what a Wahhabi is. Believing in the Quran, that it clearly states that I'm proud of being a Wahhabi. If that's what it means. I would understand this. So do not be deceived and tricked by people who mix and match things. And they hide things and call people names and accuse people of things. And as we've said before, in our explanation of the Surah Falaqah, if Muhammad ibn Abdul Wahhab was a bad person, and he was an agent for the British, and he was sent to destroy the Ottoman Empire, and whatever they say, no problem. What aqidah do you want the people to be upon today? Billah alayk. Qulni anta iblis. Fadl. What do you want? Get rid of Surah Falaqah, Kitab al-Tawheed, get rid of all Wahhabi books. No problem. Hebra, isha aqidah, aqidah from that's my name, tayyib. What aqidah they gonna be on? Go to the graves, swear by Allah and Allah, superstition, palm readers. That's what you want? You want the people to have talismans and bracelets and amulets with names of jinn and shayateen going to the awliya? Is that what you want? Because Ibn Abdul Wahhab's aqidah is all false and it's all made up and it was nothing but a means of destroying the Muslims. Tayyib, no problem. But give me a better substitute. Tafaddal. Give me a substitution of shafa'ah is only for Allah. And that you can't go to the graves and ask for shafa'ah. La'ana Allahu man dhabaha li ghayrillah. Give me an alternative to that. If you can't, then you have to do what? You have to submit. And it's much deeper and it's much bigger than just Muhammad ibn Abdul Wahhab. But it's an issue of qala Allah, qala Rasulullah. And however those words come to us, and those words are explained and categorized and broken down, then what's the problem? What's the problem? If Iblis makes a statement of truth, are we not supposed to accept it? Fabi'i Zadika. He swore by Allah's might and Allah's izzah. He says, most of your servants, you won't find them shakirin. They won't be thankful. Did Allah say that you lied? You were wrong? No. Allah never said that Iblis told falsehood. What he said when he was kicked out of Jannah was what? It was true. And the Prophet of Allah, what did he tell Abu Huraira? When that old man, that poor beggar came and stole from the sadaqah, and he grabbed his hand and he says, I'm taking you to the Messenger of Allah. He says, please, I have wife, I have children. Don't report me. We're starving. Let me steal. So Abu Huraira, he felt pity for him. He let him go. And then the man came back the second night and he stole again. And Abu Huraira had more pity and more compassion for him. And the third night, he says, not this time. You're getting in trouble for stealing from the wealth of the Muslims. And then he says, if you let me go for the third and final time, I'll give you something that is much, trust me, the deal is worth it. For you to let me steal three times and let me go, what you're getting is worth 10 times more than this. I'll give you a gem that you can't forget. That if you recite this, Allah will protect you. And no shaitan will come to you until you wake up. And he told him, Ayatul Kursi. The Prophet said, he told the Prophet, Abu Huraira told the Prophet about who came and what he looked like. And what did the Prophet say? Some narrations say that he smiled, huh? He says, do you know who your guest was? Do you know who your night visitor? Do you know who that man was? Sadaqaka wa ish? Kadub. He says, he told you the truth even though he's a what? A pathological liar. Kadub. They said Kadib. He's a habitual liar. But right now he told you the what? Truth. So what Ibn Abdul Wahhab was or wasn't does not come in front of what Ibn Abdul Wahhab is saying in his book. Kitab al-Tawheed, al-Ilm wa haqqullahi ala al-Abid. Qala Allah, qala Rasulullah. Istighatha, isti'adha, nadar, all that stuff mentioned in Kitab al-Tawheed. Do you dispute all that? If Ibn Abdul Wahhab was a kafir, if he was a mushrik, if he was, what he ended up, are you disputing what he's saying in his book? Is that you cannot go to the graves and ask for other than Allah. You can't ask, you can't swear for other than Allah. You can't swear by other than Allah. You can't make vows for other than Allah because of Allah and His Messenger. So Ibn Abdul Wahhab and his aqidah was all made up and it was all created by the kuffar, no problem. But what are you replacing it with? This is how you have to think critically. It's not an issue of a personality. It's an issue of the deen, the proof and the evidence. And if you cannot prove the hardcore, solid evidence to falsify what I'm saying, you can't say anything about what I want. What I'm saying. It's just that simple. So if you can prove what the Aqidah of Islam is supposed to be, other than what's mentioned in that book and those books, I'm more than welcome to take it. And being a Wahhabi, of course, is all false and it's all wrong. Are you understanding the conclusion I'm trying to get to? So it's not a joke, guys. Alright? The Prophet ﷺ does not own things. He does not control people. He does not have the ability to take one from Allah's wrath. His own uncle, his blood, his flesh, and the one who took care of him. The only thing that he can do is ask Allah to reduce his punishment. So how can you then say, before we go to battle, we say, oh Muhammad, help us and support us in this victory. All of our soldiers should wear an eye thing, a nazar, to protect us from evil, protect us from being defeated by our enemies. And if you snatch it off, and you say it's haram to say that, and you can't swear by the Prophet, then you're what? You're a Wahhabi. The Prophet couldn't help his own uncle, and he's going to help you? Does that make sense? Honestly, intellectually. If there was anyone that he could help and save, it would have been who? Without a question. It was his flesh and his blood. And Abu Talib was the one, by Allah's permission, who kept him safe. And if it wasn't for Abu Talib, perhaps Waliyad ibn Lab Quraysh would have had a better chance at harming the Prophet. And that was one of the only reasons why they left him alone, was because of Abu Talib. And he was a mushrik. And he died upon shirk. And when the Prophet ﷺ was asked, مَا نَفْعَلْتَ لِعَمِّكَ What did you do for your uncle? فَإِنُّ كَانَ يَحُبُّكَ وَيَغْضَبُ لَكَ The narration says that he used to protect you and he used to be angry for you. What did you do for him? And this goes to show us the importance of paying back favors. And the dispraise of being low and base, being a person of no honor, and you don't repay the favor that's given to you. It's a bad thing. They asked the Prophet, what did you do for Abu Talib? He was your uncle. What did you do for him? How did you repay him? And he says that I asked Allah, perhaps, that he would reduce the punishment and allow him to wear those waliyad ibn Lab, those sandals, which will cause his brains to boil, waliyad ibn Lab. And he's the least of the people in the hellfire. So the Prophet ﷺ had any power to do something, and if the Prophet ﷺ had any magical ability to save someone and protect someone, it surely would have been the one whom he owed, let alone it was his flesh, it was his blood, it was the one who was like his father, and who kept him safe. So that aqidah is totally false. That the awliya have power and control, and they can do things, and they can protect you. And if you say that that's incorrect, then you're a Wahhabi, and you hate the awliya of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Moving forward. He says here, intercession for permission for the believers to enter paradise. Intercession for sinners is not specific to the last messenger. As I said, the prophets, martyrs, scholars may all intercede by Allah's permission. And of course, there are conditions for the Shafa. First and foremost, is that Allah has to allow it. And secondly, that Allah has to be pleased with one who is interceding and pleased with the one who is being interceded for. Al-Ibnu wa-Ridha. Allah has to allow it. You can't do it unless I give permission. Until I say so. And secondly, Allah has to be pleased with the Shafir and the Mashfur. Or al-Mashfur ilahu. And Allah is never ever pleased with anyone unless they're upon what? Tawheed. وَلَا يَرْضَى لِعِبَادِهِ الْكُفْرِ Allah is never pleased with kufr for his servants. إِنَّ اللَّهَ عَلَانَ Allah has cursed the what? Huh? Allah says that he's cursed the who? The kafirin and the munafiqeen. So how can he be pleased with them? So you cannot seek intercession in an improper way. And Allah's intercession that Allah allows would only be for someone who's from the people of Tawheed. So if you make shirk, you automatically disqualify yourself for the possibility of getting it. I would understand this. And if you make bid'ah, and you do it in the improper way, you've disqualified yourself for the possibility of what? Of getting it. And that is taken from no other place except from the Quran and the Sunnah. مَنْ الَّذِي يَشْفَوْ عَنْدَهُ إِلَّا بِي إِنِّي I would understand this. Tayyib, moving forward. Chapter 10, the reckoning and the requital. So we did chapter 8, right? We did chapter 9, and now we're on chapter 10. And the last chapter, inshallah, we're going to take is going to be chapter 11, right? The four chapters for today. Tayyip, who's our reader right now? We need a new reader. Who's going to be the reader? Anybody volunteer to read? Nobody wants to read. It's just English. It's not Arabic. Nobody wants to read. Wallahi, that's sad. Tell them, Nafis. Tayyip, bismillah. So here, this is the summary of everything. What's meant by reckoning and requital? Al-Hisab. And you can sum all of this up into the one simple statement, you reap what you sow. You reap what you sow. Or as we said, one's action, one's profit. It's that simple. You live a good, righteous life, you'll see the reward for that. You live a wicked life, an ignorant life, you'll also see the reward of that. On this day, like we said, people will be, and there are others who will be lowered. Allah will be pleased, and Allah will be angry on that day. And there are many things that are going to take place, many spectacles and phenomena on that day. Supernatural things that will take place on that day. How do we know what those things are? Except for what's in the Quran and the Sunnah. It's just that simple. The orthodox creed of Islam regarding reckoning, requital, the Day of Judgment, is nothing more than the what? Quran and Sunnah. It being explained, broken down, categorized, branched off, as I previously said to you. Everyone understand this? Forward. The earth will shine with the light of its Lord. Allahu Akbar. Wa ushriqatil ard. Whole earth, huh? For what? Shine. Fadal. They will not be wrong. There's no oppression. Or I made a mistake, or I forgot, or I overcounted, or it's not. No one will be wronged on that day. You'll get your deeds in full. Tayyip. This verse here is a comprehensive ayah. And it shows you what's going to take place on that day. Fadl. It's not a joke. This is someone who has infinite power, infinite knowledge. And someone who is most just. That's frightening. Everyone understand this? If you were being sentenced, or you had a court hearing, or you were in court, and the judge had a very long, long reputation for being a hardliner. A judge who had a reputation for being very harsh against people who committed the crime that you're being tried for. It's not the same as a judge. It's fresh out of school. A judge, this is his or her first case. A judge who's known for having been laxed. It's not a joke. Everyone understand this? Fadl. Tayyip. And let's move on. He mentions more ayat. He talks more details, more proofs the messengers will be brought in the arena of judgment and reckoning, and be asked about the matter with which Allah entrusted them, the conveying of the message. And their people will be asked about their message and their duty. Did you listen and obey the message? I would understand this, and this should teach us responsibility in this world as well. Just do your job. That's all I need you to do. You be a good job. You be a good student, and I'll try my best to be a good teacher. Don't worry about what I'm doing and ask me what I'm doing. You do your job, which is more than enough. And me successfully doing my job is more than enough to keep me, for keeping me busy. If we both focus on our own responsibilities, we can have better harmony and chemistry, a husband and wife. Most husbands and wives, they fight and they differ because they focus on each other's responsibilities at the expense of neglecting their own responsibilities. The husband's worrying about his wife and what she's not doing and this and this and so on and so on and so forth. And maybe she isn't doing those things, but you yourself are forgetting your husband or your responsibilities of a husband. And you're not focusing on you being a good husband and vice versa. She's not focusing on her being a good wife. If everyone focuses on themselves, then later on, you can start having a critical dialogue. I don't like this about you. I think you should do this better. I think that you don't give me what I deserve. But that's after you've solidified your what? You're part of the threat. So Allah is not going to ask the messengers about this and that. He's going to ask them, he's going to speak to them about their duty and their responsibility. And that was to convey the message. And when Allah asked them about the people, they will obviously say, you know best, oh Allah. You know better than we do. We're just servants. That's all we were. You know this, oh Allah. So this is a very important concept that we should learn from this. Is to focus on our responsibilities and play our roles properly. An average person doesn't play his or her role properly. The average person. The average husband, the average wife, the average coach or player, they're worrying about the next person's role and duty more than their own. Hey, on that great day, he will stand up and testify against the people. Speaking of what they did, the witnesses are the angels who used to record everything that a person did. The prophets and scholars will also testify against the people as the earth, sky, nights, and days. The people will be brought, etc. That's the delayed order that I don't think of suffer. And they will be set before your Lord in lines. وترى المجرمين يومئذ مقرنين في الأصفاد سرابيلهم من قطران وتغشى وجوههم النار ليجزي الله كل نفس ما كسبت إن الله سريع الحساب. And you will see the مجرمون, the criminals, disbelievers in the oneness of Allah. On that day, مقرنون, they'll be bound together in fetters, chained up, locked up. Their garments will be of pitch, pretending to tar. Huh? And their faces and fire will cover their faces. A'udhu billah. That Allah may requite each person according to what he has earned. Truly Allah is swift at reckoning. Huh? You know how hot tar is? What do people use tar for? And what else? Roofs. Huh? How hot is that stuff to lay down a roof? Pitch while the other billah. That being on your face. That being on your body. And their faces being covered by fire. This is all from the spectacles of that day. May Allah protect us therefrom. And he mentions all of these different ayats. And you will see each nation humble to their knees. All of the details regarding the resurrection, regarding, not the resurrection, excuse me, the reckoning and the requital. We spoke about the resurrection already. Will the kuffar be questioned? Why will they be questioned? Why is Allah asking them and he already knows? Are their deeds weighed if they don't have any good deeds because they weren't believers? It's a serious question. And obviously the answer is answered by the Quran, and it's a clear reason why they are questioned, and other verses which affirm that they will not be asked. We don't have time to discuss that right now. Moving forward. Maghrib, what time we gotta stop? 4:50. All right, tight. So I want to stop here, and inshallah ta'ala, hopefully, to the end of the chapter, you guys can navigate your way. And I think, inshallah, I just have one more session, one more chapter with the book. And Allah Azza wa Jalla knows best. Alhamdulillah, Rabbil Alameen.